Good morning and welcome to Youth Sunday. For announcements, we will be starting pizza sales. Pizza order forms can be turned into any RCYF member or sponsor. Please order before March 1st. Order forms will be available at church. They were also sent via email with this week's Salem News. Power connection is open to all 6th through 8th graders. It will be held from Friday, June 25th to Sunday, June 27th at Bethel University in St. Paul, Minnesota. If anyone is interested in going, please contact Christy Haben or Kelsey Geardis by March 1st. Are there any other announcements? Shout for joy to God, all the earth. Sing the glory of his name. Make his praise glorious. Say to God, how awesome are your deeds. So great is your power that your enemies cringe before you. All the earth bows down to you. They sing the praises of your name. Will everyone please stand if you are able and join us in this praise song?
Now will you join me in responsive reading? Now faith is being sure of what we hope and certain of what we do not see. For my Father's will is that everyone who looks to the Son and believes in him shall have eternal life, and I will raise up at the last day. Who is it that overcomes the world? Only he who believes in Jesus is the Son of God. We know also that the Son of God has come and has given us understanding so that we may know him who is true.
Let us pray. Almighty Father, you alone are worthy of all praise and thanksgiving. You give us the promise of eternal life and allow us to experience the goodness of your creation. We admit that we take your blessings for granted and fail to recognize that you provide for us. We thank you for your everlasting love and mercy. When our desires turn from you, Lord, work within us to fix our hardened hearts. Create in us pure hearts and help us to keep our eyes on you. You tell us that you will never leave us or forsake us, and that you will draw near to us if we draw near to you. Lord, help us draw near to you to this day. As we gather as a congregation, God, we thank you for the freedoms we enjoy in this country and that we are able to come together to praise you. Lord, strengthen the ministries of this church and of your church around the world. Help us to aid in the spreading of your word, for you say there is rejoicing in heaven when even one additional sinner repents. Be with the missionaries who are advancing your kingdom, and be with Christians around the world facing your persecution. Give them the protection and courage to persevere through their suffering. Lord, we come before you in awareness of our current times. We ask that you put an end to the pandemic and bring about peace in our land and around the world. Be with all those who have lost loved ones due to the virus. Bring them comfort and compassion in their time of need. Even through the darkest valley, you are with us. When you come to earth, you faced all the trials and temptations that we face today, Lord. Help us to devote ourselves to prayer when we face tests of our faith. Let us find joy in all circumstances and allow your spirit to work for our growth, even during the most difficult times. Lord, forgive us when we have failed you in our words, our thoughts, our actions, and our inactions. We know that nothing we say or do can make us worthy of the gift of Christ, yet you still give freely to all who call on your name. We thank you for the gift of your Holy Spirit and the guidance and wisdom you give. Lord, transform us, renew our minds, help us to store up treasures in heaven. We thank you for the story of the Bible and for the promises you made to bring redemption to mankind. Your love endures forever and your faithfulness continues through all generations. Bring your blessing upon us, Lord. In your exalted name, amen.
Our RCYF report. Due to COVID, our RCYF activities and fundraisers have not been normal. Last March, activities were suspended. We were able to start back up in October. In November, we went on a fall outing, and we went to Great Shots where we golfed and ate. Then we went shopping for Operation Christmas. We packaged up 6 boxes for the kids. In December, we had a Christmas party in church. We ordered in pizza and had a gift exchange and played catchphrase. We will be having our first fundraiser. We would appreciate all your support since we didn't miss out on the 2020 pancakes, supper and auction, and the Thanksgiving soup and pie. We are starting pizza sales. We will be selling frozen pizza ranch pizzas. We choose to keep our fundraising local, and we'll be getting the pizzas from the George Pizza Ranch. Upcoming events include hopefully having a pancake supper and auction in April. 9th and 12th graders will be going to Rocky Mountain High in July. 6th and 8th graders will also be going to Power Connection in June. We look forward to these events. Thank you for all your prayers and support.
Can all the children come forward for children's sermon? Good morning, everybody. Can anybody tell me what Emily is holding in her hand? Braxton. A flashlight? Okay. Do you know how to run it? Okay, let's see. It's not working, Braxton. What's wrong with it? What do you think? Out of batteries? Check. Do you know where the batteries are? Empty. No batteries. The batteries are missing.
I think I have a solution to this problem. In this box, we have batteries that are labeled the Holy Spirit and Jesus. The Bible says that Christians like you and me are supposed to be the light of the world, but we are kind of like this flashlight. We don't have Jesus living in our hearts or the Holy Spirit working in us. We can't shine any light, can we? But when we have Jesus and the Holy Spirit living inside us, then we work like this flashlight. There we go.
That's so much better, isn't it? Now, we have small flashlights for you all to take home as a reminder that you can, too, be the light of the world.
But first, let's pray. Dear Jesus, please show us how to spend this day sharing your love in every way. Help us to be kind to everyone, to play and laugh and have lots of fun shining your light and giving your grace, sharing your joy. Amen. So you guys can all come get a little flashlight and a piece of candy.
Scripture daily read now, John, Isaiah, and Matthew. So John 1:1-9. In the beginning, the Word already existed. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. He existed in the beginning with God. God created everything through him. And nothing was created except through him. The Word gave life to everything that was created, and his life brought light to everyone. The light shines in the darkness, and darkness can never extinguish it. God sent a man, John the Baptist, to tell about the light so that everyone might believe because of his testimony. John himself was not the light. He was simply a witness to tell about the light. The one who is the true light, who gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. He came into the very world he created, but the world didn't recognize him. Isaiah 40:21-31. Haven't you heard? Don't you understand? Are you deaf to the words of the God? The words he gave before the world began. are you so ignorant? God sits above the circle of earth. The people below seem like grasshoppers to him. He spreads out the heavens like curtains and makes his tent from them. He judges the great people of the world and brings all to nothing. They hardly get started, barely taken root. When he blows on them and they wither, the wind carries them off like chaff. To whom will you compare me? Who is my equal? Asks the Holy One. Look up into the heavens. Who created all the stars? He brings them out like an army, one after another, calling each by its name. Because of his great power and incomparable strength, not a single one is missing. O Jacob, how can you say the Lord does not see your troubles? O Israel, how can you say God ignores your rights? Have you never heard? Have you never understood? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of all earth. He never grows weak or weary. No one can measure the depths of his understanding. He gives power to the weak and strength to the powerless. Even youths will become weak and tired, and young men will fall in exhaustion. But those who trust the Lord will find new strength. They will soar high on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint. Matthew 5:6. God blesses those who hunger and thirst for justice, for they will be satisfied. So I'd like to introduce our guest speaker today, Adam. He's been here before, and we're glad to have him here today.
Already got it. Wow. Woo. Thanks, Cody, for the awesome intro. Hello, Salem. It's good to be back with you. I'm excited to share just a piece of God's word and what he's been speaking in me lately. So I'm really excited about that. When they asked me to come for Youth Sunday, I was like, yes. And I looked at my schedule. And I usually, you know, it's kind of a habit over the years. I'm a huge Tampa Bay Bucks fan. And I look at the dates, you know, and I kind of plan ahead in my head. And, you know, I'll look at the wild card and, oh, you know, I could be really busy this weekend if we make the playoffs. And the divisional, and I'll circle that. And then, you know, oh, the AFC Championship game, I'll just put that on there. And then, of course, I'll plan for the Super Bowl. I've been doing this for years. And just like a good Vikings fan, I, you know, it's like I could see it, but I just can't ever think it'd be a reality. So I put it on my schedule anyways, you know, and I looked at it like, man, the Chiefs could, if they made the Super Bowl, I don't know what I'd be doing that day. And, but I'm constantly challenged when, what, I don't need this on here, they call it Chiefs Kingdom. So is what they call Chiefs fans. And I, every time I hear that, I kind of like double back a little bit, because I'm a humongous Chiefs fan. If you've known me very long or very little or follow me on social media, we like the Chiefs for sure. And I got season tickets a couple years ago, so I try to get to bring my buddies, and we just have a blast going to different games and stuff. But they call it Chiefs Kingdom, and as a preacher, and I got a Master's of Divinity, that kingdom word messes with me a little bit, because it's about allegiance, and the number one thing that Jesus talked about was the kingdom of God and his kingdom. And so when I hear that, it's always just a reminder for me. I'm like, this is cool. I love it. I'm used to making Chiefs stuff and nobody notices. I wear a Chiefs thing and nobody makes a comment. That's just life of a Chiefs fan normally. But we won it last year, and I said we as if I'm on the team, but that's how excited I am about it, you know. And for any Viking fans, I just want to tell you there's hope, you know. I was waiting and waiting for every possible way for this thing to nosedive, and we were down like 24-0. I thought it was going to crash. And anyways, it ended up winning it, and this year it's like, what in the world? This is getting used to actually people noticing and watching my Chiefs stuff. It's just, it's too weird. But I say all that because as fun as that is, those things are so short today. I'm going to have do I have a picture up here? Yes, okay. I'm going to have a little party, okay? We're going to have some fun. I'm going to bring over some buddies. I pay them all to wear red. Just to make me feel better about myself, but I'm going to have a party, and it'll go, and something will happen, they'll win or lose or whatever, but this thing, when I look back, and I started looking back at old Super Bowls and different players, and I have older jerseys, but they just kind of lose their, like, if I wore you guys probably wouldn't care, but a Dwayne Bowe jersey, you'd probably be like, oh, okay, who's that? What is that jersey? It loses its flashiness over time. Today's a big day for football, but eventually it'll just be like last year. I was at last weekend. I'll talk for football a few more seconds. Don't get me started. It is Super Bowl Sunday. And a Bills fan yelled at me, and I had just a little flag that said Super Bowl champions, and thinking like, if I was ever the champ, I'll just wear that and people will respect it. The guy goes, this is what he says to me. He goes, that was last year. I was like, what? We're still the champs, like right now. Nobody's taken it yet. But it's like, that was last year. And it just got me thinking, like, this is so short. This is so, it's not a forever thing. So when I talk about Chiefs Kingdom or the Kingdom of God, you guys, it's the forever thing. It's something that you can get involved with that's eternal. So for me being here today, to me this is part of it. It says that God is the beginning, he's the middle, he's the end, he's the first and the last, Alpha and Omega, he's forever. And when I think about coming here and just getting to speak out of God's word and share something with you, it's the moment that you get to be reminded that the spirit part of you is eternal. So even in you, God's spirit is in you. And it's those things that when you sing a praise song, that's, you don't think about it like that, but you get to dine with the divine. In a way, it's an eternal thing that you're getting to be a part of. And these things are so temporal, but we get a praise and we get to open God's word, and it says that his is forever and his kingdom is forever and it'll never end. And so I'm just excited to share with you today. I want to say a prayer and then we'll jump right into it. Father, what a day to praise your name. You are the beginning and the last. You're the Alpha and the Omega. It's all yours. The kingdom's yours. Today, as your people, we come and just bow down. We come to just rest. We come to drop off some stuff that we've been carrying, that we need to be reminded that we belong to you and that you've got rest for our souls. Will you be our strength? In the middle of life, will you give us joy? Will you remind us to take each breath as the gift that it is, for this whole thing is a gift from you. So we thank you, we praise you today, no matter what we're going through. In Jesus' name, amen. Did you guys notice that? I walked in here with a red jacket, of course. And this is just a backpack. And I think we all, in a way, have a backpack. You showed up today. Bring in whatever you have, whatever's happened to you, your life experience, your past. Some of you do bring one of these to church. Kelsey for sure did. Yeah, we were talking about it. You know, as a mom, you bring this backpack, and it's called a diaper bag. But the diaper part is like, you know, that thin, and it's not really big. And how many diapers do you need to fit into this diaper bag? What that thing is a entertainment center. It's got food and games. It's got what ifs and blankets and what happens if somebody, you know, does the I don't know how to nicely say this, spew on you, or out the back. We call that a blowout. What is that? What that is? Stuff like that could happen, and this needs to be in this bag, right? It's preparation and knowing what could come. But we all carry this bag in a way, this emotional thing that we carry in, our lives, our backgrounds, the houses that we grew up in, our families. We bring this stuff with us wherever we go. We don't even think about it. Sometimes it's the words that people speak over us. They sit on us. Some unintentionally, they just said something to you in a short little moment, and you can't stop thinking about that one little thing that they said to you. Sometimes it's a hurt. Sometimes it's a pain. Sometimes it's a struggle, something that you've been carrying for a long, long time. The thing is you guys have no idea what I brought in my bag. And the person next to you, you don't know what they're carrying. You don't know what word somebody spoke to them. I had last week, somebody spoke a word to me, and just a little tiny word. But that one little word brought me back. It's like I went back in time. And I was like, oh, I was carrying that, but I got rid of it, right? I was done with that thing. And then all of a sudden, I got reminded of what was in my bag, and then I put it back on my back. Like, I'm still carrying it. I'm still carrying it. We carry all sorts of things in our bags. Emotionally hurts. And the reality is we're all carrying something. There's something, though, about being willing to go in there and purposely finding what it is you're carrying and doing something with it. I don't know the ways that you've been hurt. I know you're humans. And I know that humans have a way of hurting each other. We have a way of carrying stuff. And today I want to talk a little bit about light and light. I want to talk about weight and weight. I want to talk to the young people. They call you lightweights. And I want to remind you to be light and to wait. Lightweights. That's what I want to talk about. I want to show you a picture as we get started. We're done with that one. Okay, perfect. Now that, wow, that does look like a mullet. I'm going to say it. Yeah, it really does. A couple years ago, I got to go on this really amazing trip. Probably one of the coolest trips I ever did. I got invited to go to the Holy Land, right? And I don't even know what I signed up for, but I got to the Holy Land. And one of the places that we went was the lowest place on earth. Has anybody ever heard of the highest place? What's the highest place above sea level that you can go? Does anybody know? Help me out. Mount Everest? Nailed it. Perfect. Somebody said it like a question mark. Mount Everest? Not sure. That's all right. This isn't a test. This next part, though, is, does anybody know the lowest point? So Mount Everest is the highest, the lowest point in sea level. I'm talking Flow Rider. Low, 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 low. Does anybody know? Any guesses? It actually exists in Israel. Have you heard of the Dead Sea? This is me in the Dead Sea. Literally negative 1,378 feet below sea level. At that point, it's just pretty low, right? It's kind of like when they say, what's the degrees outside? Negative 7, negative 9. Once it hits negative, it should just say negative. Does it matter if it's negative 11 or 20? Can you really tell? Like, I can tell 70 to 50. There's a difference there. 50 to 30, right? When it's 50 around here, we celebrate like it's the best. Like, people take their jackets off wearing short sleeves. Wow, it's 50, right? If it's negative, it's just negative, okay? So this is the Dead Sea. And what's crazy about it is they said, hey, you can go in. And does anybody want to swim? I'm like, yeah, I want to swim. So this is me in college. I don't know what was going on with the hair, but this is the lowest point on sea level, the shores of the Dead Sea. 33% of that water is salt. Isn't that crazy? It's like a waterbed, y'all. It just, if you could tell, I'm not sitting on a rock under there. My fingers are completely sprawled out, and the dumb look on my face is just like, can you believe this right here? You actually can do this. You can. There's places even in Sioux Falls where you can. It's called floating, and they put you in this little container, which is a little weird at first. They can drop the sound. They can drop the light, and you're just. You can take a nap on water. It sounds wild, but you literally can just lay there and float, and it's supposed to just kind of reset you, take away all your senses, and for a moment you can just be reminded that you exist. I love it, though. I love to actually do the floating, but this picture reminds me of just lightness, of letting go. I couldn't believe what that felt like to just float on water. They told me they need to put some Vaseline on any cuts because the salt could really sting, you know, 33% salt. As I was on the lowest part of the whole world, I had a reminding or a remembering. I think it's cool that you can go to the lowest point on the face of the earth, and at the bottom of the bottom, you can be held. And I think it's truth about our God is that you could be at the lowest, the darkest, the weakest, the saddest. And I think that's still true about who our God is that he's a God who holds you. That he holds you together when you don't have anything going for you, when you don't have anywhere else to go, when you're just at rock bottom, where only up is from where you're at. That's the God we serve. At our lowest, he's our hope. At the darkest, in science they say that dark doesn't really exist, light does, but dark is where light doesn't exist. In the scriptures, there's so many times that you can pick this book up, and I love this book, young people, because it describes itself sometimes, but I think the coolest word to describe it is as a flashlight. It literally says that it's a light unto your path. It's a lamp unto your feet. It's like you're in pitch dark and you don't know where to go, and it'll just teach you just enough to take the next step and to take the next step. But to walk this world and to be in dark spots without a light, it's really difficult. This book is amazing. Sometimes we keep it real nice and clean and tidied up, but actually it's a collection of thousands of years old writings from different spots. Of course, you got the old and the new, but they're both actually just old. It's old writing, right? 2,000 years ago, right? But the truths about it from even then still ring true today, because it's about truth and it's about light and it's about this giant story. We call it history, but it's really his story. And anyways, I tell you all that because, of course, you have the Old Testament, which just means it's really, really old. And I wish they kind of used different colors to show you how old each different book of writing was so you could kind of see it. Because sometimes they'll, like, quote something in the New Testament as if you knew exactly what they're talking about in the Old Testament, right? It's like when you quote a movie and people don't get it, it's like the people who do get it are like, oh, that was really clever, and that was really good, you know? Like, I could just quote this. Some of you might know exactly who I'm talking about. Happiness can be found in even the darkest of times, but one only to those who remember to turn on the light. Who's that? Anybody know? Dumbledore is the correct response. So if I said that to a Harry Potter person, they're like, what? I get it. That's awesome. But when you quote the scriptures, sometimes you don't know what they're quoting. But when you get it, it's like a light goes off because it brings you right back. In the writers of the New Testament, they're constantly doing that, where they're saying something like, you assume they know exactly what they're talking about, but if you don't, you'll miss it. All right, let me give you a good example. Jesus is on the cross, right? He's literally paid it all. He's done it all. He's lived the perfect life. He's going to the moment, like the highest moment. Jesus had this best friend and a buddy, and their parents were actually like They weren't twins, but they were womb mates, kind of. Like, his name's John the Baptist, which they just labeled him John the Baptist. I don't know why. He baptized people, but you're like, I wonder what his last name is. It's just John. John, the guy who baptizes people. And anyways, their moms were friends. Jesus' mom and John's mom, and they actually met up before they were born. The scripture teach us that they crossed paths. Do you maybe have somebody like that? A mom who had a friend who was pregnant at the same time? And, well, that's how it was with John the Baptist. And anyways, fast forward, those two meet up, and John's like in a jail cell, willing to give his life for this Jesus and who he says he is. And John is in the darkest. He's in the low spot. They're trying to kill him and take his life, and he's questioning everything. Like, what is this whole thing even about? And John is about to give up, like he can't go anywhere from here. And he says to reach out to Jesus, are you really the Messiah? Are you the one we're waiting for? And Jesus sends word that, yes, I am. Jesus goes to the cross, and he screams out a couple things from the cross. The last thing that he says is that it is finished. But right before that, he screams out in Aramaic. And if you miss it, if you don't know what he's saying, you'll miss that he's really giving you a quote. He says, Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani. He says in Aramaic, my God, why have you forsaken me? And if you just read those words, you're like, okay, Jesus, you're on the cross. You've done everything. You've given everything to this point. And then all of a sudden you're like, you call out to God and be like, you've forsaken me. You've forgotten me. You've left me here. Have you gone through something hard and felt like giving up? Or just said, God, like this? It seems like Jesus is saying that. Like, God, what the heck? This is the worst. From the cross. But if you know the scriptures, the Jewish scriptures, you know that he's quoting. If you have a Bible next to you, just look up Psalm 22. An ancient songbook. I want you to see this. Psalm 22, verse 1. If anybody opened it up, you're going to follow along. It goes like this. Ready? My God, why have you abandoned me? Why are you so far away when I groan for help? Every day I call, my God, but you do not answer. He goes on, and this is why they call it prophecy, is because Jesus is very specifically calling out this Psalm 22. He talks about a voice in the wilderness in Isaiah, but he says all this because he's about to say, the Lord is my shepherd. Psalm 22 is right before Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I have all I need. He lets me rest in green meadows. He leads me beside peaceful streams. He renews my strength. He guides me along right paths. And even though I walk through the darkest valley, I am not afraid because you're with me. In your darkest, he's your light. In your weakest, he's your strength. Now, here's the tricky part about the strength, and the scriptures are clear about it, is that your strength, your weakness is actually God's strength. So it's less about you. It's really about how you handle the things that you are weak with. So if our weakness is his strength and that his joy is my strength, it says something different about the things that we carry. Because we do feel weak. We feel sad. We mourn. We carry stuff. One word can send us right back to the same spot. For me, I went to see, I still do, I see a counselor. And I've heard this nickname for Jesus that never really stood for anything to me. They called him the Wonderful Counselor. And I never knew what it meant. And now I think I know what that term means. And I think it's the perfect word for Jesus, because a wonderful counselor knows how to walk with you in your weakest stuff and speak a word of kindness right over it. And my counselor gave me this brick, and I was like, what is this all about? And she said, Adam, you need to learn how to care and not carry. And this kind little word in this moment was like a reminder to me, is like all of these things that I carry. And Jesus says in Matthew 6, come to me. The invitation is to come. The assumption is that you're carrying. We are carrying stuff today. We're carrying COVID stuff. We're carrying election stuff. We're carrying family stuff and pains. We're carrying. Sometimes stuff we don't even realize was put on us. We're carrying. But Jesus says this, to come to me. The invitation this morning is to come, that you're invited. You're already invited. At your lowest, your darkest, your weakest, your saddest, whatever you're walking through, the invitation is to come. Come to me, all who are weary and carry heavy burdens. And God's got something for you. He's got rest for your soul. I want to just speak about two words, one light and one weight. And I think these two are so important. Light, now I talk about the light as the scripture, being a light. In Matthew, right before Jesus says that, come to me all who are weary, he says a little bit about you're the salt of the earth. Now there's a difference between being salt and being salty, all right? If you're taking notes, he doesn't say be salty, he says be salt. Because salt, when it's added to something, it makes it better. It gives it taste and flavor. Salt and light are put right next to each other. And then he says, you're the light of the world, a city on a hilltop that cannot be hidden. No one lights a lamp and then puts it under a basket. Instead, the lamp is placed on a stand. In the same way, let your good deeds shine out for all to see. Now, I want you to check that if you're taking notes. 5, verse 16, Matthew. In the same way, let your good deeds shine for who to see? For all to see. Who's all? Other people, right? So when we're talking about being a light, because you guys are light, you're walking in the light. You have literally what John the Baptist says is the light of the world that came to show things how they really are. That's why it's so important to stay close to Jesus. One, because Jesus is going to constantly remind you that he's the light. And then you become a reflection. When you're around the light, other people will see it. And then the other is that when you're with the light, to stay light. If I can tell you one reason to follow Jesus this morning, I promise you, when I gave my life to Jesus, is I got a lightness to my life. The burdens that I was carrying, the pains, the hurts, those things, he's constantly inviting me to drop them off. He's the one who's got the strength. He's the one who wants to carry them. It's an invitation to you, no matter what you carry, you weren't made to. You weren't made to carry it. He was. He can handle it. It's like the invitation is to constantly take those bricks that got, like, I don't even know how that got back in there. I didn't put that in there. Right? A couple years ago, I went through a divorce, and somebody said something just offhand, and then all of a sudden, I was back carrying it, and I was like, I thought I put you somewhere, right? And that's what can happen with the hurts and the pains, but the invitation isn't that, because they're going to come. Hard things are going to come. Things that weigh you down are going to come. Burdens are going to come. But Jesus says, come to me with them. I will take them. I'm easy. I will give you rest for your soul. You weren't meant to carry them. So don't just be light. Get light. figure out ways to walk with people. Young people, I want to say this to you. This is Youth Sunday, and I'm so happy that you brought me. But sometimes light can just be like, hey, have it all together. Shine bright. Everybody, look how awesome you are. But also being light is just this. Being able to handle your weaknesses in such a way that you can say me too to people. Because when you say me too, it's like you don't have to have it all together. Actually, in your weaknesses and not having it all together, like in the next couple years, you're going to have to find a college. You're going to have to get all these answers to life that you are like, honestly, I have no idea what I want to do, where I want to go. I'm not sure how it'll all unfold. All I know is right now I'm just growing, which is such a cool season to be in. Just a season of growth where it's celebrated. And as you get older, we celebrate the growth less. We don't take moments to celebrate. You just kind of figure it out. But we all need growth. We all need these seasons. And a reminder to get light, that Jesus is going to carry these things. That's how you be light. It's not just having it all together. It's reminding people that God's presence in you is reminding you to drop stuff off. Let things go. The world will constantly remind you of why you should hold on to it. It'll give you multiple reasons. And what can happen is if you hold on to this stuff, it begins to harden your heart. And that's how the opposite of being light is, by staying light, by staying easygoing with what you're carrying. The other is the weight. In this world, to get strong, you have to lift weights. And if you're looking at me, you're like, okay, this isn't a guy who lifts weights very much. I'm not really, you know, pound for pound. I'm definitely a lightweight for sure. But there's a difference in these weights. One is like heaviness, and one is like waiting. And God has, I think, three answers to the things we ask him. He says yes, no, or wait. And having the patience to wait for the right thing at the right time. You guys have to make choices about things that really you have no experience with. You've never gone through. You're not sure what it looks like. And if you can have the ability to see past the present and look forward and trust that God has good things for you. It says this in Isaiah 40. Isaiah 40 has another callback, which I love it. It has a quote, and it talks about John the Baptist without talking about John the Baptist. Isaiah 43 starts like this. Listen, it's a voice shouting, someone shouting in the wilderness, clear the way for the Lord. Make a straight path through the wasteland to our God. It goes on, and as we heard our reading today, and I just love it. Have you not heard? Have you not understood? The Lord is the everlasting. He's the forever. He's the never stopping creator of the earth. He's the one who spoke this place into existence. He put everything in its place for its time and its season. It says he never grows weak or weary. There isn't something he can carry that's too heavy for him. No one can measure the depths of his understanding. He gives power to the weak and strength to the powerless. Even young people will become weak and tired. Any young person feel weak and tired in here? Are you carrying stuff that you weren't meant to? It says young men will fall in exhaustion, but those whose trust is in the Lord will find new strength. When we wait on the Lord, those that wait in the Lord. I love that in some ways it's translated trust in the Lord, those who put their trust in the Lord, and then the others is, but those who wait on the Lord. Because to wait on the Lord, you have to trust him. You have to look past the temporary and go, God, you have something better for me than everything else that I'm seeing. Young people, I hope you're hearing that when you put your trust in the Lord and you wait on him, he's got better things than just the temporary. He's got something to give you, a life, a purpose, a destiny. He's got great things already in you. As you wait on him, you'll find it. Young people, who wait on the Lord will find new strength. You'll fly, you'll soar like an eagle. You'll run and not grow weary. You'll walk and not faint. And a life that'll be a burden, you'll have a lightness. Because every single one of us has one of these. And it's full of all sorts of different things. Some, we're not even sure how they got in there. But it's learning where to put them, how to stay light. And how you stay light is by waiting on the Lord. And he promises this, that he will renew our strength. Church, if you're in a dark spot, a hard spot, a heavy spot, a spot maybe you haven't been in, maybe it's a depression, maybe it's a reminder of something that happened long ago, I want to remind you that you can come. You're invited. Jesus has a special spot for you just as you are. Not that you have to get everything together, then come. No, you can come with it. Because remember, he's the one who carries it. He's the one who you get to give it to. And remember to be light. Last week I saw somebody grab a $100 bill. And he said, this $100 bill, how much is it worth? $100. And then he crinkled it up. He said, how much is this worth? $100. And then he took it and he spat on it. And he said, and he took it, threw it on the ground, smashed it up. He picked it up. He said, how much is this worth? $100, right? And so many of us, we look at our worth from what we do or earn or how well we're put together. But the worth was already on it. And it happens with us too, with the things we carry and the struggles we have and our failures. We lose track of how much we were worth. He went on to talk about a baby and how a baby's born and the mom and the dad, they love this baby just as it is. It literally has nothing to give or take. It leaves us surprises every once in a while on the back and all over your clothes. One time I was holding my niece and I was like, we were having a sweet moment. And I was like, I don't want this to end. And I gave her to my mom and I was like, wow, I was holding her a long time. I was really sweaty. I go, maybe that ain't sweat. I think she peed on me. And mom goes, Adam, that ain't pee. But I think God holds us in even the crap that we carry. He's not afraid of it. In fact, at your lowest, he just wants to hold you and remind you who you are and how much you're worth. Because he's the one who determines that you belong to him. Let's pray. Father, in a room this size, I can't imagine the things we're carrying. I know we're human, though. I know we've been wronged by something somebody did, something said, something we did, something we said. God, we have guilt and shame, things that are not of you, things that we've been carrying. I pray in the power of your Holy Spirit that things in here would be released, that people would be set free, and not by my power, but by your power, your resurrection power. Speak life over dry bones. Speak peace to our pieces. Free us, Father. Let us be held and reminded that at our lowest, at our darkest, at our deepest, that we're yours. You're not afraid of our junk. And that you love us. You call us your own. You call us beloved. You call us sons and daughters of the Most High. Father, help us to be light in a dark world. And may we show people the eternal, life-giving kingdom of God. The best thing on earth. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Please rise and we'll sing a closing hymn. Check, check. Yes, let's get our RCYF team up here. Come on up here, guys. I celebrated a birthday last week, and I'm realizing I'm about twice as old as you guys now, which is, it's awesome. But this whole thing is a gift, you guys. I want to speak something to you, over you, from the church. Because sometimes we say you guys are the future church. And what we mean by that is you are going to take this thing, and this is going to be yours one day. But what we really mean is that you already are it. You are the church. You're not the future church. You're the church right now. In your schools, in your cities, wherever you go from here, you are the light of the world. You are the salt of the earth. That's why the things you say, the actions you do, your ability to forgive, the ability to chase things away and hand things off to God, He's using you already. And it's not like, okay, you got to just be on a stage and speak, or you got to do this thing or sing a solo. Whatever thing it is, you do it for the kingdom of God, for His glory. And the way He works is He uses tiny things. Literally, there's a part where it just says, even a cup of cold water. Have you ever gone on a long run? Have you ever been super parched? Even a cup of water. Like, it's the simplest little tiny things that remind people. It shines light for the world to see. And when you shine light for the world to see, it's not like you're earning God's, like, He already loved you. You didn't earn it. You already were. But it lets them praise God because it lets you get in on His kingdom work. And I just want to tell you, He's already using you. You're already doing it. Keep going. You don't have to have it all together. He does. And He's going to keep using you. So we're here to celebrate you guys. That's the whole point. So I need your hands like this. In a second, I'm going to say 1, 2, 3. You're going to clap like this and just push, okay? Now you guys, this is going to be awesome. You're going to have to take your hands out of your pockets because what the church is doing here, and we're not very good at this. We don't really know what to do. We're like, oh, should we bless them? The point of today is we're blessing you guys. So they're going to do that 1, 2, 3. And I want you guys to just like, like let it hit you, okay? Because that's what we're here to do, is we're blessing you guys. We're saying that you're not the future church. You're the church right now. Stay light and wait. Put your trust in the Lord because you're awesome lightweights, but the world needs them, all right? You ready? Church, 1, 2, 3. Bless you guys. Go in grace and peace. Peace to your pieces. I'll see you next time. And, oh yeah, go Chiefs!
Thank you everyone for joining us today, and thank you Adam for the awesome message. There will be cookies you can take to go in the narthex. Please join us in saying the RCYF prayer. Now, may God cause His light to shine in darkness, cause His light to shine in our hearts. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.